be here and giving me the opportunity to present my work. So today I shall be talking about strange quark stars in Lorentz violating theories of gravity, in particular in Holography gravity and in Einstein ether gravity. So as I will mention later on, when we study spherically symmetric objects, the structure equations are the same in both theories. And this is a work done in collaboration with these guys here. And our work has been published in this journal, and you can find it in on archive. And this is the preprint number of the manuscript. So the plan of the presentation, first I will try to motivate the work. Then I will remind you very briefly how to describe relativistic stars in metric theories of gravity. Then I will discuss the impact of Holography gravity on the properties of strange quark stars. After that, I will show you in plots our main numerical results, and finally I will conclude. So as you know, Einstein's general relativity is a theory which is very beautiful and at the same time very successful. Over the last 100 years or so, it has passed several tests and it has made the several predictions that can be confirmed. So one can mention, for instance, solar system tests like the deflection of light or the periastron advance of the planet Mercury. And also another thing is the existence of black holes, which is by now well established. Here you can see the motion of stars around the supermassive black hole at the center of Milky Way. And here you can see the first image of the shadow of another supermassive black hole at the center of another galaxy. And finally, we can mention the detection of gravitational waves, both indirectly and directly from the advanced Virgo and LIGO collaborations starting 5 or 6 years ago. However, there are good reasons to believe that Einstein's general relativity should be extended somehow. And one argument in favor of that is, for example, the current cosmic acceleration. So there are several observational data from cosmology and astrophysics that show that we live in a flat universe which undergoes an accelerating expansion dominated by dark energy. Okay, roughly speaking, one can understand why the normalized densities have these values. For example, if you believe in inflation and you consider CMB temperature anisotropies, the first peak tells you that the universe is flat. Then using supernova data, as we heard in the previous talk, we can determine the amount of dark energy and non-relativistic matter in total. And then the relative position between the first and the second peak in CMB temperature anisotropies tells you how much baryons there are in the universe. So the rest is dark matter of non-baryonic form. And the same amount for baryons is obtained considering primordial Big Bang nucleosynthesis. So overall, there is a consistent picture for today's universe. So if one wants to accelerate the universe, one way to do it is to go back to the field equations and modify the geometric part, the left-hand side of the field equations. So you assume that you assume a new modified theory of gravity. There are corrections to GR at cosmological scales, and these additional terms can play the role of dark energy that accelerates the universe. So another argument in favor why study theories beyond Einstein's GR is renormalizability. So it was already from the 70s, it was known that if you allow for higher order operators, then you can achieve renormalizability. But the problem is that at the same time, there are ghosts. And so these theories are pathological. Now, one solution is to say, okay, what if Lorentz symmetry is not fundamental, it's rather, maybe it's accidental. So if you keep two order high, if time derivatives are of second order, then you don't have ghosts. And if space derivatives are higher, if you consider theories in which space derivatives are of higher order, then you obtain a better behavior at high end energies. But this means that you have to sacrifice Lorentz symmetry in order to achieve renormalizability. So, and this is two articles published by Kozawa in 2009, and they have attracted a lot of attention in the literature. Now, there is another work by Jacobson that appeared before the work by Holography, in which they discussed Einstein ether theory, which is a vector tensor theory. So in this theory, there is the metric tensor, and in addition to that, there is a vector, which is the Lorentz violating vector field. So in this theory, you obtain a new modified dispersion relation. The first term is the standard one, and then there is a correction, an additional term, which is suppressed by some higher mass k. So when you go to lower, to small energies, this term can be neglected, and you obtain the standard dispersion relation. But at the ultraviolet, you obtain a modified Green's function, which gives you a better improved ultraviolet behavior. So how the question now is how to test this alternative theories of gravity, non-conventional theories of gravity. One way to do it is to use compact stars, which are objects in the universe characterized by very high densities. So they offer extreme conditions that cannot be reproduced here on Earth. And so gravitational effects are expected to be important. And so in principle, one can use these objects to study and constrain non-standard physics and non-conventional theories of gravity. So on the one hand, there are white dwarfs that lie here below the main sequence stars, or neutron stars, which are more standard. But on the other hand, there is another class of compact objects which are supposed to be made of deconfined quarks. These objects are supposed to, they are characterized by a lower energy, and so they are more stable configurations in comparison with the neutron stars. They offer certain advantages. So one advantage is that, for example, you can explain superluminous supernova. So people have observed a few puzzling superluminous supernova, which are much brighter and take place way less frequently than a regular supernova. So in this picture, if you accept that strange quarks exist, this can be explained in the following way. For instance, we can assume that there are two explosions. The first explosion gives you, it's the normal event that gives you the supernova, and after that there is a second explosion due to which there is a transition of neutron stars to strange quark stars. And so in this work, for example, you can see that there is a very good agreement between theory and observations. Another advantage in favor of strange quark stars is the mass and the radius. So here I show in the same plot the mass to radius profile both for a neutron star, shown here in red color, and for strange quark star in blue color. And you can see that strange quark stars in general are somewhat smaller objects. So in the literature, it is claimed that there are some observed objects with peculiar properties that cannot be explained using the standard hadronic equation of states, and therefore they are good quark stars candidates. And indeed, here you can see that for a certain equation of state, for a concrete equation of state, you can obtain mass versus radius within the theory, and you can compare to six real objects for which we know both the mass and the radius. So here I show also the data points with the error bars. And you can see that the theoretical curve passes very nicely between the data points. So now let me very briefly remind you how to describe relativistic stars, first in GR. So since the object has a hard surface, there is the outside problem and the inside problem. So first we solve the outside problem in vacuum, there is no matter present. So in this case, for the most general line element that we can write down for the metric tensor has this form with two unknown functions, f and g. And finally, one obtains the well-known Schwarzschild solution characterized by the mass of the object. Now, if we go to study the interior solution, now matter is present, the energy momentum tensor is not zero. If the object is isotropic, then the pressure both in the radial direction and in angular direction, they both are the same. And there is a certain equation of state relating the pressure and the energy density, and this depends on the microphysics, depends on the matter content of the object. Like before, for the exterior problem, we make this ansatz for the metric tensor. Well, now it turns out that it is more convenient, instead of the lambda, to introduce the mass function m. So one of the structure equations, the Tolman-Oppenheimer-Volkoff equations that have they are given by these expressions here. So these equations have to be integrated with these initial conditions, where this PC is the central pressure, which is unknown, of course. And then matching the exterior solution to the interior solution at the surface of the star, we obtain the radius of the object and also the mass of the object. Now, if one assumes another theory of gravity, then two things happen. First, in the exterior problem, the vacuum solution will be different. So it will not necessarily be given by the Schwarzschild solution. In general, it will be a different solution. And then in the interior problem, the structure equations will be generalized. So there are extra terms of geometrical origin that correct the standard Todd equations. Of course, you understand that this is very sketchy in real, in concrete theories. The expressions can become very complicated. Now, in these Lorentz violating theories, for example, let's consider the Einstein ether theory. We write the volume in this form, so we separate the time from the three-dimensional space. And time acts like a scalar field called the chronon, And in this way, one can define a vector field normalized to unity. And the most general axiom that Lagrangian that one can write down has this form with four coefficients C1, C2, C3, and C4. Now, to study spherically symmetric non-rotating objects, for the metric and such, we make, as usual, the standard. So the line element, once again, is given by, has this form, with two unknown functions A and B. And these are the three structure equations, the TT equation, the TT field equation, the RR field equation, and the fluid equation that is equivalent to the conservation of the stress energy tensor for the matter content. So the fluid equation remains the same, but in these two structure equations, there are additional terms in blue color proportional to some dimensionless parameter nu, which measures deviations from GR. And of course, going to take the limit nu going to zero, these terms disappear and you recover the standard of equations. Now, the exterior solution turns out that is given by these expressions, where y minus and y plus are numbers that are computed in terms of this new parameter, and y is a function of R, given by you solve this a bit complicated algebraic equation, and you obtain y as a function of R. So you know the two functions A of R and B of R. Now, to integrate the structure equations, one must assume a certain equation of state for the matter content. And in particular, for strange quark stars, we use the MIT back model, and there are, generically speaking, two broad classes of equation of states. One is the linear equation of state, perhaps the most well studied in the literature is this one, which corresponds to the case in which the mass of the S quark is zero and the QCD coupling constant is zero. And there is the only non-vanishing free parameter is the back constant. But more generically, you can have two free parameters, K and rho naught here, where K is not precisely one third, and rho naught is the surface value of the rho. So in this case, P at the surface becomes zero, vanishes, and this condition allows us to compute the radius, but the energy density at the surface acquires a non-vanishing surface value. So it's impossible to make both P and rho vanish at the surface of the star. And the other class is a non-linear, slightly more complicated equation of state, but still analytical. So if you take into account QCD superconductivity effects, you obtain this additional term here. And because of this term, the equation of state becomes non-linear. And you can see that even if, and delta is the superconducting gap. So even if the mass of the strains of the S quark is taken to be zero, the gamma parameter does not vanish. So this term is always there. As long as QCD superconductivity effects are taken into account. Now, in order to check if the solution is well behaved and capable of describing realistic astrophysical configurations, one needs to check several things, for example, causality, stability criteria, energy conditions, etc. So here I am showing our main numerical results. First, I show the mass to radius profile. On the y-axis, I put the mass in solar masses. On the x-axis, I put the radius of the star in kilometers. This plot corresponds to the linear equation of state. And we have considered three of them for three different, the numerical values of k and rho s are different from here to there, And also this new parameter takes three values. The zero value corresponds to GR, and these two non-vanishing values correspond to the Lorentz violating theory. And this mass-to-radius profile corresponds to the non-linear equation of state. We have considered two of them. And we see that when the parameter nu increases, the profile is shifted to this direction. So the maximum radius of the star and the maximum mass of the star decrease when nu increases. But overall, the shape of the profile maintains the typical shape of the profile remains the same. Here we show the compactness of the star as a function of the mass of the three linear equation of states, of the two non-linear equation of states, and we see that the Buchtel bound is not saturated. So the maximum allowed value is 0.4, and here we for this equation of states considered here, the maximum value goes up to 0.3, not larger than that. Finally, to check if the other conditions are satisfied or not, here I'm showing the relativistic adiabatic index as a function of the radial coordinate for a linear equation of state. And for a non-linear equation of state, where the blue color corresponds to the linear equation of state and the red color corresponds to the non-linear equation of state. And all graphs, all plots correspond to this concrete value of the new parameter. So the adiabatic index always remains larger than the Newtonian value 4/3. The speed of sound always takes values between 0 and 1. And all energy conditions are fulfilled. To conclude, there are good reasons to believe that Einstein's general relativity must somehow be extended in several different ways. One possibility is to consider Lorentz violating theories in order to achieve renormalizability. Relativistic stars are ideal cosmic laboratories that come for free, and they allow us to study and constrain non-conventional theories of gravity. And strange quark stars, although at the moment theorized objects, they are very interesting, offering certain advantages. For example, one can explain the superluminous supernova or explain peculiar properties of observed stars that cannot be done using standard hadronic equation of states. Here we have studied the impact of Einstein ether gravity or Hojava gravity of strange quark stars. First, I formulate the problem, I present the structure equations and the equation of state, and finally I have shown that it is possible to obtain well-behaved realistic solutions within this theory. Thank you very much. I'm ready to take questions if you have. Hello?
I'm still here. I don't know where is the wood.
I think he just disappeared somehow. So anyway, are there any questions? We are only three.
I see.
So, or sorry, four actually. No, three. Oh, four, including myself. So any questions? Any questions for Grigoris? Actually, I like this topic. The question that I wanted to ask, maybe I missed it at the beginning of your talk. Why do we concentrate on the strange quarks? Because I've seen a lot of publications concentrating on the strange quarks. Why not, for example, up or down?
The up and down are always taken to be massless. So it is only the mass of the S quark can be either precisely zero or some. You can assume that it has a non-vanishing value, for example, around 100 MeV or 150 MeV.
Okay. And what about the other quarks? Like, for example, top, of course, might be difficult because the top is not stable. And what about the bottom, for example?
So the other three flavors are too heavy in comparison with the chemical potential involved in the problem.
Okay. Fair enough. So any other questions? So in that case, let's thank Grigoris for his talk. And I guess we can move to the next one.
It's me.
Yeah, Lorenzo. So.